Here we see the basic structure of the eye. Okay, so you can see this is the lens and this is the front portion of the lens, eye lens, and this is the rear portion. Here we have a bending like this, and these are projected like this. So let us see each and every part. Say the front portion here, let us say A. So this is cornea. It's a front layer like thing which where in most of the refraction takes place actually. Okay, and next part, interior part here, we have, say, let us say this one, this B, this is the crystalline lens. You can say this is just the eye lens. It's not made up of any synthetic material. It's a transparent jelly like material. Okay, we can press it and then its shape can be changed. Okay, so to hold the position, the lens in position, to hold the lens in position, we have two things over here. This is something like a stand, lens stand. Okay, so these are called, these are the muscles. See, what they do is, the function of the ciliary muscles is to hold the lens in position. And the other important aspect is, like, they are responsible for changing the focal length of the lens. Earlier we discussed that wherever you keep the object within certain range, okay, you will be able to see the image clearly. So for the reason is that in a normal lens, a glass lens, if you consider, the focal length of the lens does not change. Okay, so because basically it's a converging lens, this one is a converging lens, even you talk about a convex lens, converging lens, its focal length is constant. If the object position is changed, in the case of a convex lens, you need to change the position of the screen so as to get a clear image on the screen. Okay, that means you need to change the image distance. But here, the image is formed on this particular layer inside the eye, which we'll call it as retina. Okay, so this graded portion here completely, this is retina. So in this so image is formed on this retina. When the position of the object is changed, we cannot change the distance between the lens and the retina, right? The size of the eye is fixed. So what will happen is, this particular lens will change its thickness, maybe slightly. Okay, so to help change the thickness, you know that thin lens and thick lens. For a thick lens, the focal length will be shorter. Okay, for thin lens, the focal length will be little bit longer. So here, what's happening is, to be enabled to have the image position on the screen, the crystalline lens, which is made up of a jelly-like material, it will change its focal length, basically its thickness. Okay, what happens? How does it change its thickness? It is these ciliary muscles that help the change the thickness of the lens. When they stretch themselves like this, in the contract like this, what will happen? They stretch the lens and the lens becomes thinner. Okay, when they relax, okay, then they push this particular part, it is pushed, these two edges are pushed, that means the lens will become little bit thicker. When the lens is becoming thicker, obviously the focal length of the lens will become lesser. Okay, so this is how, what is happening. So these two muscles, the function of the ciliary muscles is to change the position or sorry, change the thickness of the lens. That is the main function. And retina, what we discussed is, it is a screen where the image is formed. Now the question comes, is it a real image or a virtual image? When you say the image is formed on a screen, it implies that the image is real image, not virtual. Okay. When the image is real, it can be inverted only. It cannot be erect, right? So that means if I have the object in the upright position over here, what will get image is inverted position. Okay. When the image is found inverted, how are we able to see the object in the straight position, normal position? What happens is, what we are talking about this retina, this is nothing but the nerve endings. It is a canopy of the nerve endings spread over the entire region of the eye, in the posterior region of the eye. This is the posterior region, this is the anterior region, front portion, rear portion. So the nerve endings are spread over the interior portion of the eye, inside of the eye totally. Okay. So whenever the light impulses are the image is formed on the retina, those light impulses are carried through this optic nerve. This portion is the optic nerve. Okay. This optic nerve carries the image impulses. So electric impulses are generated whenever this retina receives an image. So that image is converted into electrical impulses and then sent to the brain through this optic nerve. So it plays a very crucial important role. If there is some defect in the optic nerve, you will not be able to, this part of the eye may function well, but you will not be able to realize the image, because this is connecting to your brain from the eye. Okay, this is the most, each and every part is playing its role and each and every part is important. We cannot say this, the function of this particular part is less and this function of the other part is greater. Okay, now here you have this. What about this particular thing here? This portion here is nothing but a diaphragm. What happens, how does this diaphragm help? Did you any time check if you throw light directly into your eyes with the help of a torch and see what happens? You are receiving more light than it can withstand. Say momentarily you switch on the torch light into your eyes and then take it away. Be very careful, you should not experiment such things. Just for your information I am telling you. Okay. Obviously you should not play such damaging things with laser lights. Very, very dangerous. Okay. Ordinary torch light or any amount of light, if heavy amount of light is entering your eyes, you will get a glare, right? Once a flash of light is entering your eyes, thereafter you will not be able to see anything, say for a few minutes. What does this happen? Okay, you will be able to experience such an experience when you come out of a dark room, like say cinema hall. You stay in the movie theater, in the cinema hall, say for 3 hours. You come out in the daytime. So once you step out of the cinema hall, you will be able to have some glare in your eyes. You will not be able to see the light. Your eyes cannot bear that light. It will take some few seconds to adjust to the surrounding light, right? Similarly, when you step into a cinema hall in the daytime, okay, or in evening time, night time also. So outside the cinema hall, you will have some plenty of light. Your eyes are adjusted to it. Once you enter into the, step into the hall, you will see darkness for a moment, maybe a fraction of a second or few seconds. Then you will be able to see the seats and all those things, all the objects. So what happens over there? What really happens, so that you will not be able to see for a certain moment. Thing is, like, this is like a shutter for your eyes. If you compare your eyes with a camera, your camera have a shutter. The shutter opens and closes a momentary, a fraction of a second for the light to enter into the camera. Same way, this particular part, okay, this particular part is called iris. This is the iris, it's a membrane. Okay, it's a small diaphragm, it's small diaphragm like thing. So which will control the amount of light entering your eyes and protects it. Okay, you'll not be able to pass most of the light. So this will control the amount of light entering your eyes, and that is the function of this iris. Now, whatever the middle portion, this portion here you have, this is the empty area. Actually, what I have drawn is like maybe a little bit, it extends, the iris extends up to certain length. Oh, here something like this, okay. You are seeing the lateral cross section of the eye. This is not from the front portion, this is from the lateral portion, okay. Lateral side, side view of the eye. So this iris will control, this will contract and expand so as to enable. Whenever you enter into a cinema hall or into a dark room, it will expand so that more amount of light will enter your eyes and you will be able to see the objects clearly. Okay. Whenever you come out of the room, whenever you come out of the dark room or a cinema hall, something like that. So when you go from a dark area to a brighter area, then where more light is there, so obviously it will contract, close little bit and allow some amount of the light. So it will try to control the amount of light. It acts involuntarily. You mean what is involuntary? You understand what is involuntary, right? So without your knowledge, you cannot control by yourself. You cannot say, you may think that, okay, now something is entering your eyes, I should close my eyelids. You cannot have that. Even your eyelids will not function voluntarily. Okay. So they are involuntary things. Somebody comes and blows air into your eyes. Immediately your eyes, without your knowledge, the eyelids will close. So that is the involuntary muscles which are acting over there. Same way iris also acts involuntarily. Okay, so iris. Next, whatever the area is there in between the iris, in the central portion here, this is the central portion of the eye. Okay, front portion of the eye, front central portion of the eye here. So this front central portion of the eye, you have an opening. This opening, you will call it as pupil. It is just the opening. Okay. Now, fine. We have everything discussed. But one thing is like, how are these muscles able to hold the lens? What is before it and what is after it? This portion, these two portions here. Okay. They cannot be empty. They are not empty. It's not hollow. Okay. This portion is not hollow, even this portion is not hollow. You have something like fluids over there. Okay, so this is called H, if you see. Aqueous humor, this particular thing. Okay, so what happens is this aqueous humor is nothing but a jelly-like material. It's a liquid over there, completely spread in this region, okay, which will not allow the crystalline lens to change, misplace out of this. It will help the holding this. Similarly, we have some more fluid over here. This is called vitreous humor. Okay. So this vitreous humor and the aqueous humor, these two will hold the lens in position. So they maintain the pressure on both sides of this crystalline lens so that this particular crystalline lens is in position. Okay. So this is the basic structure. What happens is, like, see, front portion here A, this is the cornea. It is this cornea most of the time which is responsible for the 90% of the refraction takes place at the cornea, the most important refraction. And once the image is refraction is taking place, this crystalline lens will give the fine tuning to the particular refraction, what is happening, and the image is found on the screen. Okay, as discussed, image is inverted, but this optic nerves, okay, it helps in converting that image into a straight image. From that means making it inverted to erect, and optical impulses, the electrical impulses which are generated when the image is formed on the retina, okay, are transmitted to the brain through this optic nerve. Okay, so you can see all these nerve endings over here. There is a small dent over here, this particular portion here. This is called fovea. Okay, fovea is the place, small dent like thing here, where, and you are able to see the objects clearly with their colors. Okay, so the major of the, there are two major portion or major part of the screen, that is the retina, which helps us see the brightness and the colors. There are two cells, major cells. One is rods, one is called rods, RODS. Rods, and the other is cones. Rods and cones, these two are the two types of cells which are spread throughout the retina that helps. Rods sense the brightness. Okay, so whether the light is bright or dim, that is sensed by the rods. Okay, cones are most effective for sensing the colors. Okay, so the three basic primary colors, what we call the blue, green and red, these are the three primary colors, okay, which are taken care by the cones. They sense them, and the combination of this, all the other colors are the combination of these three basic colors. So these two help us to sense the brightness. These two are present in the retina, and these help in sensing the brightness as well as the color. Okay. Now it is this cornea which will be replaced. So when you go for cornea can be replaced from one person to the other person. Most of the blind people who cannot see, they suffer only with cornea defect. So what can happen is, if a person is died, then within minutes of time you can collect his cornea, place it safe, and then replace it to somebody blind person, then obviously they'll be able to get the sight again. That's what they say, if you donate your eyes, it is not the total eye which is donated, it is just the cornea replacement what is happening over there. So one cornea is replaced with one person's cornea who is blind can be replaced with a good cornea, where again he'll be able to revive his vision. So this is basically the structure of the eye and function of different parts. Okay.
If you like this video, please give a thumbs up. Please subscribe to our channel to get more videos on CBSE syllabus.